Domine sovisco, ecum spiritu, Sequentia Sancti Evangelii Secundum Luca. In the tempore dixit Iesus discipulis suis, attendite a fermento Phariseorum quodas hypocrisis, nihil ad hoc mertum quantum revedetur, neque absconditum quodam sciatur, quoniam pre in terris dixistis in nomine dicentur, et quodam arvela cuti estis in cubiculis predicabitur in tectis, dico atum vobis amicis meis, interi animi abis qui acidum corpus post ecum ad avent amplius quis partiam. Ostendam atum vobis, cum timeatis, timete eo qui post cum acideri, habet quod satum mitere in gehenam. Ite, ita dico vobis, unc timete, nonne, quinque pateres venium dispondio, et unus exilis non idest in adivione coram Deo, sed capiri capitis vestri omnes numerati sunt, nullite ergo timere, motis passeribus pluris estis vos. Dico atem vobis, omnis quicumque confessus pluerit me coram aminibus, epidios omnes capitebitur, et idem coram angelis Dei. Laus tibi Christe.
In the tradition of St. Louis de Montfort, let us pray, Hail Mary. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. St. Joseph, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Today is the feast of St. Placid and companions. St. Placid was born in the year of our Lord 515, and at the year of age of 13, he followed St. Benedict in the monastery Monte Cassino, newly founded. This holy boy was known for his great piety, practicing all kinds of austerities, and was a very edifying monk to behold in the monastery. In fact, St. Benedict himself saw he was so impressive in his advancement in the spiritual life that at the age of 21, he sent him to found another monastery to be bring the foundation. And so he was building this monastery for about 4 years. And into the fifth year of this foundation, a whole bunch of barbarians came along and slaughtered every single one of them. And not just simply the quick death sort of thing, but the one where they kill you, but it takes a while for you to die. And St. Placid, 30 of his monks, his sister and two brothers who just happened to be visiting, all of them died a martyr's death. Now, when it comes to martyrdom, and especially when it comes to the, especially with the crazy times that we have today, you might have thought at least at some point or another, I wonder what it would be like to be a martyr. And I wonder, if I were put to the test, would I pass it? Well, you see, when it came to St. Placid, he didn't just simply one day wake up and then decide to become a martyr. He had already been mortifying himself in terms of his love of earthly things. He had already been mortifying himself in terms of friendships and any kind of worldly attachments. He had gone to the monastery at the age of 13. He had risen to the heights of sanctity, so impressive that Saint Benedict himself, the father of Western monasticism, thought to himself, stroking his beard, that one needs to go found a monastery at the age of 21. Now, I don't know what you were doing at the age of 21, but I'm going to bet it wasn't founding a monastery full of monks. To see just how high he had risen to the heights of sanctity, this is the father of Western monasticism, Saint Benedict, actually trusted him and thought he would be the best one suited to found another monastery. It really puts things in perspective when you see just how far he had come in the spiritual life in so short a time. But back to the whole martyrdom issue. If you wish to give yourself completely for Christ, you wish to renounce everything, whether they be riches, honors, all kinds of things, St. Placid did exactly that. He left the world behind. He went into a monastery. He had nothing left to give save his life, because everything he had, all his worldly possessions, whatever he might say is his own, really belonged to God. The only thing that he had left was his life. And this he had the opportunity to offer when the barbarians came along, knocking on the door and then burning it down. Now, when it comes to preparing yourself to give yourself for Christ, perhaps God will not call you to martyrdom. Perhaps God will not call you to a bloody offering of your life. But perhaps you don't have to do this in order to give your life completely to God. So when it comes to the things in this world, there are many attachments that we might have. It might be money. It might be reputation. It might be just being the funniest person in the conversation. You want to make sure everything revolves around you. Now, what would happen if all these things that you take, perhaps little attachments here and there, perhaps they're not all that big, they don't drag you into any kind of mortal sin right now. But what would happen if we got a good old-fashioned persecution going, and anyone who calls himself Catholic, anybody who wants to remain faithful to the teachings of our Lord, anybody who wants to continue to hold to this old-fashioned Catholic religion, you have to give up your car, you have to give up your house, you have to give up your job, all these things. And you have to go into hiding, because if you find you, we're going to arrest you and feed you to the lions. Now again, to have a house, to have a car, to have a good reputation, have a good job, all these things are good. But would you trade these things for your soul? Again, if you ask St. Placid, the answer is obvious. Absolutely not. I would give everything away to follow Christ. And he did it. I would make sure there was no attachment so dear that I would this would keep me from following our Lord. If he asked of me today to give up my life, would I do it? Or would I hesitate? I don't know about that. I've got a lot of things that I haven't finished yet, some projects down the pipe. I've got a lot of good friends. They would miss me if I were to give my life completely to our Lord. This is something that we have to think about and we have to ponder well. If God were to call us to martyrdom, would you respond, or would something hold you back? And this is why it's very important for us not to simply get there when we get there, but to already start severing those bonds that hold us down in the spiritual life. You see, St. Placid was not just simply giving up worldly possessions, but he was also mortifying himself. And that means, in terms of fasting, that he wasn't going to let his stomach control himself. He was the boss. He was the one that was controlling himself. He wasn't dictated, I have to wake up at midnight, get my midnight snack in there, and then you have first breakfast and perhaps second breakfast, and then we'll see about lunch, but at least it has to be pretty hearty. He did not have that kind of mentality. He mortified himself. He subjected his flesh to his spirit. He made sure that all of these lower impulses of the fallen human nature were so completely subjected to his spirit, St. Benedict saw that he would become not just simply a good monk, but a good abbot. He would be the one who could direct 30 men under his care at the age of 21. Now, how many 21-year-olds have you met that you can say, that guy could be a good spiritual father? You know, again, it's possible. It's definitely possible. You start yourself out at 13 under the direction of St. Benedict. I would say maybe even likely. But again, if you think about it, he had mortified himself so perfectly, there was absolutely nothing that would make him hesitate. If God had called him to martyrdom, he would instantly respond. If we have any kind of attachments, be they material, or perhaps worldly reputation, or any kind of earthly consideration, when you weigh these things in the scales of eternity, where would they be for you? Again, we know the answer. We know the answer we should give, that my soul is more important than all these things that I own. My soul is more important than all the friendships that I have, my job, my money, all these things. I know the answer. I know what I'm supposed to say. But is it what you would do? Because again, actions speak louder than words. You know in the end that eternity matters a great deal more than anything that we have here in this world. And if we get this right, if we die for Christ, if God were to ask it of us, we would have an eternity with God in heaven. So no matter how painful that death might have been for St. Placid, you could imagine, as his name might suggest, a certain amount of peace, even as he is painfully bleeding out for several hours, or maybe even a few days. You could imagine the thought, soon I will be with my Lord. It may take a while, maybe several hours, the agony of death being protracted after some painful wound inflicted by a barbarian, and seeing those around him similarly wounded, also eventually going to die. If perhaps the wound itself is not going to kill you, the fact you can't get up and take care of yourself, you may die of starvation or dehydration, any number of ways. Quite agonizing if you think about it. But if you have St. Placid, who had already been mortifying himself, subjecting his body to all kinds of mortifications and disciplines, what is this? This is only a few more hours, maybe a few more days, and an eternity at the end. Would I be able to hang on to the very end? Would I be able to just hang in there just a little bit longer? Of course, I spent my life waiting for this moment. God is at the other end of this time. I just have a little bit more to go, and then I'm there. You can imagine, too, how he would have encouraged his monks. As he himself was dying, and so were they. Some probably had already died already, but there might have been a few more kind of hanging in there. Those words of encouragement from that spiritual father. Perhaps not all that old. Perhaps he was younger than some of the monks already there. Didn't matter. He was there, encouraging his monks to continue to persevere. Christ is at the other end of this thing. And if we follow our Lord, if we follow the example of St. Placid, we will have an end, perhaps not quite as gruesome as what he might have faced, but no less happy. May our Blessed Mother help us to remain faithful to Christ no matter what comes in the future. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Domus Domino Deus. Deo Dini me Deus, in sequens of the Tara, in astibis in the big gratias agape. Domine Sancti Patrum Universitum Deus, per Christum Dominum Nostrum. Perica maestatum tuam lado, cambio di adorantum in actiones, remo potestates. Cedi clarum qui veritus tapiata, seraphim sacri citazione concedebant, cum quibus et nostras vocis et viti ubi asta precamur, suffici confessione dicendem. Sanctus, 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 Dominus Deus Sabaoth, Canis Incendia Cena, Gloria Sabaoth, Hosanna in Celestis, Perdicus qui benefit nomine Domini, Hosanna in Celestis.
Thank you. Thank you.
Dominus obis.
Other officials who are appointed to guard our